What's going on, Duck Nation, College Football Nation? This is your Duck Bros coming at you. As you can see, I'm going to be running this show by myself today, and my co-host Spencer, he couldn't make it in today. He's actually got a really busy weekend going on. He's got a housewarming party to deal with on Saturday, so I also do apologize for the fact that we're doing this on a Friday. We both had a really busy week, and so we couldn't coordinate getting together to film. So today, what we're going to be doing is I'm just going to broadcast live from my room. Yeah, we're going that way today. Also, I picked up this new awesome Duck sweatshirt at the Duck store up in Clackamas. They just got these in a couple days ago, and they got that awesome Kelly Green that they busted out for the South Dakota game for a lovely $90, so my wallet is screaming right now. But you know what? It looks awesome, so I'm totally cool with it. Now that it's about a week removed from that whole crazy experience in the Michigan State game, and you know, we learned a lot of things in that game, and it's nice also to finally come out from one of these games on the positive side. They finally passed the test, and we learned many things over the course of that game, and one of them was that Oregon can finally beat these types of teams. So that was one thing that there was a lot of concern about, is can Mark Helfrich finally beat that type of team? I mean, it's been a big problem over the last couple of years with Stanford, and they finally show that they can. And I think the other big question is, you know, exactly how good is Don Pelham? Like, how is his defense, now that it's his defense, how is it going to fare against pretty much the anti-Oregon? And you know what? Outside of that really, really horrendous second quarter, I would say that he looked pretty damn good. I mean, in the first quarter, they really sent a message. I mean, they held Michigan State to no points, which was really important to start a game like that, to really say, you know what, we are ready to play, we're not intimidated by you. And they forced Connor Cook to throw an early interception to Eric Dargan, who totally got blown up by that offensive lineman later on in that play, which was pretty funny. I'm glad he didn't get hurt, though, because he got lit up. And, you know, we didn't learn too many new things about Marcus Mariota in that game, obviously. I mean, he made a lot of really, really great plays, a lot of important and clutch plays that we'll get into a little bit later. And I think two other things that we learned was, we learned how fast Devin Allen is, which is really fast, by the way. That play that he had in the first half with the long pass play where, you know, Mariota gets it out to him and he's going downfield, and the defensive back tries to, you know, grab him by the jersey, and he spins off of him and goes into the end zone anyways, was super tight. That was an awesome play, and dude, that guy can flat out run. It is crazy. And then another thing that we learned is that, at least this isn't an observation that I'm making, but I think that, you know, Royce Freeman is taking over this running game. I mean, so far in these first two games, I mean, he has been easily the most impressive, and he also looks the most comfortable in this offense that Oregon's setting. I mean, not to take anything away from Thomas Tyner, but he hasn't quite really settled in just yet. I mean, he's, you know, I'm sure he will as, you know, as the season goes on, but Royce Freeman has just absolutely come out ready to go. And obviously, in the first half, Oregon struggled a pretty fair amount in the run game. The offense, on a whole, kind of struggled outside of those couple of big plays that they scored on. So that was one thing that was kind of hard, is that in that second quarter, you know, Oregon had the lead, and we finally thought that, you know, this is going to be the moment where they kind of decide to, you know, dig the grave for Michigan State and finally put it to bed. And we thought that, you know, maybe this is going to be the moment where we finally trash them and everything's going to be awesome. And then the second quarter happened, where Oregon's defense morphed into a piece of Swiss cheese, and all of our fears were realized once again. I know, I was watching it from work, and I remember saying it to myself, because I was the only one working up front. I was like, oh God. I was like, they found the blueprint. They finally figured out how to play against us, and now here it comes. I mean, because they scored 24 points in a row, and all the energy in the building just went, it was just gone. I mean, Oregon couldn't move the ball. They couldn't stop a thing on defense, and Michigan State was getting wide open running lanes, and just, you know, third down conversion after third down conversion, and we're just sitting here ready to pull our hair out. And, you know, we go on to halftime, and you know, Michigan State, all their players are totally pumped up, and Oregon players are definitely not at that point. And we're kind of all thinking, oh no, is this going to be where Oregon falls apart and they can't recover, or what's going to happen? And then the halftime adjustments happened. Absolutely monstrous kudos to Mark Helfrich, Don Pelham and company, because the adjustments that they made were absolutely spot on. I mean, Michigan State scored 3 points the rest of the game, and they never looked in sync, really, at all after that. I mean, the defense totally cracked down. I mean, they were getting pressure on Connor Cook. They were finally getting some running lanes for Freeman and Tyner. And, you know, finally receivers were getting open, and they were getting wide open, by the way. The second touchdown that Devin Allen caught, there was just nobody around at all. And it was great. I mean, the one thing I'm concerned about is the strength of the offensive line. I wouldn't really say the strength, but the depth now, because you know, after the second injury that they've had to deal with this season, we were kind of all wondering, oh God, this is bad. But Tyrell Crosby came in, he got the call, and he was ready to go. I mean, he looked really good. Now, he definitely made a couple mistakes, as you know, a young guy is going to make, but he looked good out there. I mean, he definitely helped provide Freeman with some good blocking, and man, it was awesome. It was great to see, you know, Oregon's offense and defense both clicking at the same time, and it was fantastic. You know who I'm really impressed with, by the way? Joe Walker. That guy was everywhere. It was awesome. It seemed like every time I looked up, he was just getting in the backfield and you know, wrapping up Langford and keeping him from getting a big gain. He was everywhere. And Eric Armstead was a beast in that game. And it was such a relief. And off from the offensive side of the ball, even though they did struggle in the opening part of that third quarter, the second half of it is really when the floodgates opened. And, you know, Mariota was getting room to run around, and he was getting enough time to throw, and his receivers were getting open, and just everything was finally starting to kick in. And that was kind of the one thing that, you know, every Oregon fan was wanting to see, that moment where Michigan State finally breaks down, as, you know, that's kind of what Oregon does. I mean, you wear them down, and you finally start to exploit the weaknesses in the defense, and it all kind of happened at once, because, I mean, people were just wide open, and everything was clicking, and Oregon looked completely unstoppable at that point. There was all these big plays that needed to happen, and Oregon was getting them. They were getting, you know, third down conversions, and on defense, they were preventing third and fourth down conversions. That fourth and one or fourth and two that they stopped was huge, not to mention the awesome full extension interception from Ifo right there by the goal line was outstanding. It was a great play. I remember when I saw that, I stood up off the couch when I finally got home, stood up off the couch and just yelled with my arms up in the air like this. And man, it was super cool. So in summation, we passed the test. Oregon finally passed the test, and they looked good doing it. Like, it wasn't what I thought it was. It wasn't what I or what Spencer thought it was going to be, where we thought it was going to be like a 24-21 game or a 23-20 game, or with some other people, maybe like 17-14. It definitely wasn't that at all. Both offenses came to play, and it exceeded my expectations all over the place. I mean, outside of the second quarter, it was a really solid performance from Oregon. And you know what? The nation took notice. I mean, they went up to number two. They got numerous number one votes from people in the AP. And Oregon's looking good. You know what? I think one of the bigger observations to make right now, and I know we're only 2 weeks in, and you know, things will change as the season goes on, but this looks like Oregon's conference to lose. Like, they finally look like a dominant figure as it sits right now, because from what I saw from Stanford, they didn't look that great. And I know that USC is really good, but even USC in a lot of areas didn't look that great either. UCLA, I have no idea what's going on there, but they've got some problems to figure out. I mean, they barely skated by Virginia, who Oregon totally destroyed last season. And they really struggled mightily with Memphis. Now, I'm a Memphis fan for basketball mainly, but so when I saw that game was close, I actually went upstairs and I put on my Memphis jersey and I came back down. I was totally going for him. It was funny. I really wish they would have won that game, because I actually made a bet with Spencer. If Memphis won that game, I was going to do this week's videos with a Memphis jersey on. I was going to do it. I didn't even care at that point. But they lost, so you know, I didn't do it. But it was interesting, you know, all the same. Washington didn't look good against Eastern Washington and all these other things. But the biggest thing to take away from week two is that they did it. They finally did it. Helfrich has his marquee win now. Don Pelham, you know, from what we've seen so far, is shaping up to be a solid coordinator. And the team is just gelling together really well. I mean, there's a lot of new talent on this team. And, you know, they're all performing really well. And I think that's something that we can all look forward to, you know, in the future. And, you know, it's only, you know, Braylon Addison's going to be coming back at some point. So it's going to be another lift for the receiving core. You know, the defense is looking good. Hopefully the offensive line can stay healthy and no more injuries. We don't need any more of those. And we're just going to continue to see how the legend of Royce Freeman and Marcus Mariota continues to unfold. So with all that said, this has been UO Duck Bros saying thank you guys for watching. And as always, go Ducks. I'll see you in the next video for the prediction for week 3 at Wyoming. Peace out, guys.